We get shocked sometimes when we see people do atrocious things. And sometimes these people who are doing these things are not shocked. To them, it is normal. Obviously, they are under some kind of influence. And I'm not talking about a substance. I'm not talking about alcohol. I'm not talking about a drink. I'm not talking about smoking, or I'm not talking about a drug. For the most part, these people are under some influence in terms of their philosophy. And I want to introduce a new series where we are going to discuss this powerful subject that I've titled The 7 Deadly Philosophies in the Modern Job Market. We're going to be talking about jobs and some of the 7 deadly things or detrimental things that people normally do in terms of job seeking, job acquiring, job keeping, getting promotions, and so on and so forth. So you want to stay tuned for this.
Welcome to the Life Signatures Podcast with Lawrence Namale. Lawrence is a life coach, author, and keynote speaker who loves to tackle different topics on purpose, productivity, and resilience. His mission in life is to awaken all your boundless possibilities available in you. Life Signatures Podcast is dedicated to bring to reality every single person who knows that deep down in their gut, there's got to be more to life than this. And now, here is your host, Lawrence Namale.
Probably the things that you're doing in life today are affected by the philosophies that you have believed in, the philosophies that are guiding your way of life. And I do not know which position in life or which level in life you are at the moment, but you're going to be successful or otherwise depending on the philosophy that is in operation in your life. If you have a philosophy that downgrades you, detriments your beliefs that you are a nobody, chances are that you will not face the success that you deserve or that you've been equipped potentially to have or to acquire. The philosophy you believe in, the belief system that is inside of you, that is operational, it is the one that is going to determine the length, the breadth, the height, the width of your success. Let me just give you an example. Somewhere in September 2013, a group of hooded terrorists stormed an upmarket shopping mall in Kenya's Westlands area. I think it's called Westgate. And these people, they went hurling grenades, shooting indiscriminately at innocent Kenyan shoppers. Amongst those ones who were rescued, wounded, and the dead were small children playing innocently. There were women and there were also men. These terrorists went ahead and they staged a 3-day hostage crisis that had the attention of the major news channels in the world, including Al Jazeera, CNN, BBC, Sky News, and CCTV. See, these people who did that, they had a philosophy, a strong philosophy that was guiding their actions. Why would you go and kill an innocent child and face death, face the prospect of being shot dead yourself? It is because you are believing in a particular philosophy. There's always a reason as to why we do things the way we do. And the way of our living is going to be affected by our philosophies. We get results on a daily basis in our lives depending either consciously or unconsciously on the philosophy that we have subscribed to. Whether we know it or not, it is in operation. The philosophy is inherently working. And at times we pick these philosophies from our environments. At times we pick these philosophies from our parents. If you have a parent who believes you are stupid and all the time they are telling you are stupid, you're going to pick a philosophy of stupidity, even if you are sharp and gifted in other areas, and you might easily shrink. So we pick these philosophies from our environments, and we also pick these philosophies from the people who are in authority over our lives, parents and teachers. I've just come from listening to news, watching news, or hearing people talking about a girl child in Kenya who committed suicide because a particular teacher called her names and shamed her because of her menstrual periods. And that is a philosophy that is being peddled. That was a philosophy that made her make that detrimental decision in her life. The main reason as to why those terrorists did what they did is because they subscribed to a certain philosophy. Never mind how airheaded, how stupid, how archaic, how inhuman that philosophy is, but it actually motivated their actions. And the same thing with job seekers in today's job market. They have philosophies that they have subscribed to. And these philosophies, for the most part, these philosophies have been bred over time through the culture that we find ourselves in. And I'm going to be discussing those seven or so philosophies that are detrimental in the existing, current, present job market. Because those philosophies used to work in the decades that have gone by, but they do not work in our day. In our day-to-day lives, in the present world, these philosophies are now archaic, they are detrimental, they are old-fashioned, for lack of a better word. And I'm speaking this because I have gone through the system, I have gone through this issue of job seeking, I've gone through this issue of not having the correct academic papers, not having the correct people to connect you to the job. I have gone through interviews upon interviews and failed. And I have walked around this earth, quote unquote, on a jobless mode to such an extent that if you offered me anything, just about anything, as long as I am working, I would have taken it. And I know it's in response to how we were wired inside of us to work. And so job seekers have these philosophies that are detrimental to them. And years back, I was jobless for a space of a year. There was a period of time that I was jobless for a space of a year. And when I finally got an opportunity, and this space of a year was because I had walked out of a previous job that I held because I just got tired of it. I wanted to quit that job 7 months after I got it, but then I ended up quitting 4 years later on. And you can imagine how wasted my time was in those 4 years. So for a period of 1 year, I stayed jobless. I stayed without a job, and I was staying at home going through tremendous suffering that I do not want to wish on anybody else. It was, I think, a period of 1 year and a half, give or take. I just barely made it. I just barely survived from day to day. And finally, I got an opportunity to attend an interview. And I had already experienced many fears of lack of cash, lack of food, lack of rent, lack of the right papers. And frankly, I could not care less. I had my attitude at that point in time was, I have attended as many interviews as possible, and each and every one of them I had flunked, and this is just like another one. But I was so carefree to such an extent that the interviewer was, my life was not necessarily in the hands of the interviewer. My life, I had said, come what may, I am here to do whatever it is that, if I get the job, fine. If I don't get the job, fine. And so what I did is that I did not put on any mask. I was my real self, my authentic self. And needless to say, they loved me, I think, and that's why they give me a job. And that's one hiding reason that I'm giving you. But the real reason as to why I got that job, I believe, is because I was forwarded there by a friend of mine who was the project manager. This company was actually doing, it was a contracted company where I was sent to. And the main organization had a new project that they were experimenting on, and the project manager happened to be my mentor, and he's the one who forwarded me to them. And probably they felt obliged to hire me and give me that job, not because I was qualified for it. Why? Because they were looking for someone who has a degree, and I did not have that paper. But the area that they wanted me to work was an IT related field, and I was good at that. I've explained that in the previous episodes, and I don't have time to go much into that. So I put my hands on the plow and I got into this job and I started working, and I found that it fit me like a perfect glove. You know, me and doing those things, doing the IT work that I was appointed to do, it fit me like a perfect glove. I loved what I was doing, and it so happened later on, maybe after a year or two, there was a vacancy that occurred in that organization. I did not even know about that vacancy. I did not know that it existed for a period of maybe 1 month or 2 months, as organizations were making, you know, contractual negotiations. They were negotiating over this thing. I did not know it was existing. A multinational mobile network operator was interested in being served by my boss's company. And all that this boss needed to do was to get two seasoned employees that could become expatriates for the very first time in the history of that organization. And so let's look at the odds that were against me. Remember, we were talking about the philosophies, the detrimental philosophies in the modern job market. So what was I up against? And this was happening even when I was not in the picture. No clue that they were looking, headhunting for someone. Number one, I did not have a degree, like I've said, in just like a dead record, a broken record. I did not have a degree. And I'm going to talk about this later on, because there's a philosophy about degrees and it's a detrimental philosophy in the modern job market these days. Number two, what was against me is that I did not even know that that vacancy did exist. And so I could not even apply. I could not even converse. I could not even, quote unquote, prepare myself, package myself so that I can, you know, apply and be amongst the top. Because anytime there's a vacancy, you need to know and you need to prepare yourself, fortify yourself so that you can increase your chances of winning. I did not know it existed. Number three, I was 55 or more levels below the pecking order. In fact, there were more than 56 people above me who would have naturally, in the order of natural progression, they would have gotten that opportunity ahead of me. There was a manager, there was an assistant manager, there was a client service manager, there were 10 regional leaders, there were 40 field personnel, and then there were two of us in the back office. I was one of those two guys. So I was very many degrees below the pecking order. I didn't even know that I was going to get it, even if I knew that the opportunity did exist. Look at the odds that were against me. And I think, by the way, I think I wouldn't even have dared to apply. That's how bad it was. And then number four, I was in the very extremely bad books with the boss due to office politics. That very year, I remember it as if it was yesterday. That very year, I was told at the beginning of the year that, Lawrence, I was supposed to fire you. You're supposed to get out of this organization. There's something that has kept me from firing you, but I have been given news. I've been told that you are rude. I've been told that you are lazy. I've been told that you are only hell-bent on playing your guitar, you know, because I used to come to office with my guitar so that I could go and play it in a spiritual group that we used to meet every Wednesday. And so that was the verdict for me at the beginning of the year. I felt like I was being targeted, and of course I was being targeted, really. And so these four things were up against me. So what made this boss overlook all these odds against me and appoint me amongst the two people? I'm talking, this organization had more than 70 people, if I could count, who were better than me in my thoughts, who were higher above the pecking order than me. And to add salt to injury, I was in bad books with the boss. What made this boss overlook all these odds against me and appoint me an expatriate? I did not even know the boss was considering me in the first place. To be honest, because, you know, there was office politics, I was working in fear more than working in optimism, knowing that the slightest mistake, in fact, that was my last strike, the slightest mistake would easily send me home. see the greatest mistake that job seekers today are doing, and I did this a lot, is to think that interviews are only done in boardrooms with an interviewing panel. I have come to realize that the opposite is true. Life is one long, long interview. See, when you're waking up in the morning and nobody is seeing you, no prospective employer is seeing you, you are attending an interview. When you choose between social media and feeding your mind, you are attending an interview. When you're volunteering to work somewhere and you're giving your A game there, you are attending an interview. When you're helping someone in the office, you are attending an interview. When you're giving recommendations instead of complaints, you are attending an interview. Life is one long interview. The next level is going to be determined by what you are doing, not because someone is seeing, but what you're doing at this level is going to determine how your next level is going to be. And that's how it was for me in that particular job opportunity. So when I was called into the office, to be offered this job, I knew for sure, because any flimsy excuse would have sent me home, I knew that my goose was cooked. I was gonna be sent home. But that what was waiting me over there was something totally different. And like I stated earlier, life can only be understood. See, it can only be understood when you are looking back, not when you're looking forward. When things, you look at how your life has come up all this way, and you can be able to make a review, and you can be able to make deductions, and you can be able to make meaning out of it. Not when you are in life itself at the moment. So looking at my years as a job seeker, and even as an employer, I have deduced several detrimental philosophies in the modern job market. And it's my belief that these detrimental philosophies are affecting the modern people, the modern job seekers, in very many ways. And I'm going to discuss this in the succeeding episodes. But I want to leave you with one point. The point is this. See, an interview is not something that is conducted in a boardroom. Technically, it is. But I can tell you this, life itself is one extremely long interview that is happening every second the clock is ticking. And there are very many people interviewing you. There is life itself. By the way, life has a way of promoting people. My friend Betty Ogiel has, and I've quoted her very many times, she has said this. She said that if two people are seated on a bench, an opportunity was to introduce herself to either one of them, opportunity will introduce herself to the person who is most prepared. And that's how life is. Interviews are happening. Life itself is interviewing very many of us. When I'm doing this podcast, for some reason, I am being interviewed by life. There are very many things that I'm doing on a daily basis that are acting as an interview for me, unbeknownst to me. Of course, there's gonna come a time that you will sit before a panel. Likely, you sit in a boardroom before a panel, and that will be as a result of you passing very many other interviews in life. So I got the job. In fact, I was not even interviewed when I was called into that office. I thought I was going to be fired, but surprise, lo and behold, I was offered a job. And this offer was something that I had never dreamed of in my entire life. And like I've shared in the previous episode, sometimes an illusion, a reality happens to you, and then you can make an illusion comes out of it, and you can make an identity out of that illusion. And my identity had been altered when I was told that I was rude and that I was one strike away from being fired. I thought that I was useless. I thought that I was not needed. I thought that I was in bad books. I thought that I was going to be fired in any minute. But I was called into that office and actually offered a job. The that was going to pay me 3 times higher than what I was receiving at that moment in time. And there were other additional benefits, and there was a car involved, and there was a flight involved, and so on and so forth. And I got this job against all these things that I've mentioned to you. Number one, I did not have a degree. There is a philosophy about degrees that we're going to talk about. Number two, I did not know the vacancy existed. There is a philosophy of people looking for jobs that have already been advertised, and they are decreasing more and more. And number three, I was 55 or 56 levels below the pecking order to be selected. There is a philosophy about merit that we will need to deal with. And then number four, I was in bad books with the employer of the day. But at the end of the day, I ended up getting the job. The modern philosophies that we are using today will be detrimental in creating an illusion of joblessness for us, wasting precious time in the recruitment process and giving employers a headache in getting the right people. So we are going to discuss in length these detrimental philosophies in the modern job market, and I need you to stay tuned. If you are either looking for work, or you know someone who is looking for work, or you know someone who is looking for a job, stay tuned to this channel. We're going to talk about these things, discuss about these things in length, and hopefully change your philosophy so that you can come to that level that you are employable and you are a champion of working to express your inner talent, your inner skill, to express your tenacity and your resilience, to bring your A game into this world, to make your glory to shine on the face of the earth, because you are created to do exactly that. So stay tuned and thank you for listening.
Thank you for listening to Life Signatures Radio. If you enjoyed today's show, subscribe to Life Signatures Radio on iTunes, Stitcher, or visit our website at lifesignatures.libsyn.com. Life Signatures Radio, fresh, clean, and inspiring.